Good morning.
Good morning.
And praise the Lord.
Amen.
Bible tells us in Psalms that it is good to worship the Lord. And it's also good to praise Him. So for whatever reason that you came this morning, I pray that it was to lift Him up and to glorify Him.
Amen.
We don't come to glorify or to worship our sin.
Amen.
We come to glorify the one and only true living Christ.
Amen.
Amen. If you would, let's everyone stand to our feet. I know we have many needs, and I'm sure that you all have needs as well. And we serve a God that made us a promise that He would supply all of our needs according to His riches and glory. Not according to ours, but according to His. And I'm thankful that we have a God that loves us enough that He showers us with His love, His kindness, and His tender mercy. No matter what it is that you're going through, I was reminded this week, right after a storm.
Amen.
Thank you. Because the storms are coming. Not if, but when they come.
Amen.
We have to count them as joy. Because God's still in control.
Amen.
Amen. Lord, we just thank you this morning for allowing us to come before your presence this morning. Father, we thank you that you are such a wonderful, great, and merciful God.
Yes.
Lord, we thank you this morning that you woke us up and clothed us in our right mind.
Yes.
That we can come and glorify you and lift you up. Lord, I pray that you would just have your way in this service today. If there's anyone here that needs healing, God, I ask that you would let your healing virtue flow this morning. If there's anyone here this morning that needs to be saved, God, I pray that you would just touch and save them and let them know that the only way that they can make it to heaven is through you. Lord, we ask that you would just have your way in this message today that's coming, that it would be healing, that it would be uplifting, it would be encouraging to someone that may be down this morning. Lord, we just give you the praise and we give you the glory. We give you the honor that you are rightfully due. And everyone said,
amen.
Amen.
You were.
took up our pain,
yes,
and bore our suffering.
Yes.
Yet we considered him punished by God, stricken by him, and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions.
Yes.
He was crushed for our iniquities.
Yes.
The punishment that brought us peace was on him. But by his wounds, we are healed.
Amen.
God, guys, whatever we go through, he knows exactly what we're doing.
Amen. Yes,
you know. appreciate the presence of the Lord.
Amen.
I don't ever want to take that for granted. The Holy Spirit is here today. I'm glad that you're here. Look at that person next to you. Tell them they look good on Sunday morning. That's good.
Heavenly Father, Almighty God, as we already come into your presence, feel your awesome, divine healing, Lord, fill our bodies with grace, peace, joy, and love. Father God, we thank you for Jesus that got this head and said, You know, I'm going to come back to see an eye. This means, my God, why did you forsake for that moment? He endured that for us. We thank you, God, for it. So when he pierced inside us, forth with the same water and blood, and then he gave his life so we could have life and have his abundance as we know it today. Thank you, God, for Jesus, Father. We take the bread, Lord, as we, the body, Lord, as the blood represents the wine, Lord, or the dirt juice, whatever we use, God, represents you, God, your only begotten Son, Father, in the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
kidding. I'm sorry.
And in our minds this morning, God, in total reverence, no talking, no moving around, in total reverence of the old rugged cross today, to see your beaten body, beaten beyond recognition for us. We partake of it together in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Let us partake.
Sisters, because of the unity of the blood of Christ. And Lord, as we take this cup today, we ask you, dear Lord, to let your anointing and your Holy Spirit just kindle a fire deep inside us today. Prepare us for the word. Prepare us for what you have for us. And Lord, we partake in the name of the Father and of the Son. Somebody ought to say praise the Lord.
Praise
you
God.
Just pass your cups to the middle. The brother will pick them up. Brother West, sing that first verse again for us. And one more chorus of the old rugged cross.
Thank you.
you can today. I feel a very strong anointing of the Holy Spirit in this house this morning.
Amen.
I feel the forerunner, which is the Holy Spirit, has went before us today to prepare our hearts and our minds for the Word of God. You know, the Word of God has promised to never return void.
Amen.
Amen.
Tongues will cease. Everything else will end. But the Word of God lives forever.
Amen.
And I want to share with you from my heart today. I want to talk to you about the family. Now I want to tell you ahead of time, I'm probably going to make some of you mad at me today. But you have to love me anyway.
Amen.
When the Holy Spirit burns something on my heart, I have an assignment.
Right.
And I have to deliver that assignment. Or I will stand before God for not doing so. So the old cliche, if the shoe fits, wear it. If it don't, say amen or oh me, whichever one it is. Take it to your heart. My goal is to help you reach your destiny.
Amen. Mom.
That's it. That's my ulterior motive, is to see you. I love to see you get stronger in the Lord. Oh, it does something joyous to my heart to see people come in so broke and so hurt and so disarrayed, and to see you every week get a little stronger. That's the power of the Holy Spirit in our life, and that's what restoration is all about, isn't
Amen.
It? So I'm asking you, if you feel the unction in the Spirit today, to pray for me over the next few minutes.
Amen.
If you have your Bible, I'll ask you to stand one more time for the reading of God's Word. We're reading from the Old Testament this morning in the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 30. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy, which is the fifth book of the law written by Moses. The book of Deuteronomy, you'll hear a lot of Hero Israel. It says Moses was giving the law as he was speaking to God's people, speaking to the children of Israel. Over and over and over again, he began to speak things. And he spoke something in the 30th chapter. I want to tell you how I feel in my heart today. Can I just be real with you?
Amen. Amen.
This is life or death for someone here today. No games, no gimmicks, no playing around, life or death.
Amen.
And here's what the Bible says here in Deuteronomy chapter 30, verse 15. If you're there, say amen.
Amen.
If you don't have it, we have it for you here. See, I have set before you today life and good, death and evil. And then I command you today to love the Lord your God, to walk in His ways, and to keep His commandments, His statutes, and His judgments, that ye may live and multiply. And the Lord your God will bless you in the land which ye go to possess. Verse number 17, but if your heart turns away so that you do not hear. How many of you can hear me today?
Amen.
Thank God that you're hearing the Word of God today.
Amen.
But if your heart turns away that you do not hear, and you are drawn away and worship other gods and serve them, I announce to you today that ye shall surely perish. You shall not prolong your days in the land which you cross over the Jordan to go in and possess. I call heaven and earth as witnesses today against you that I have set before you life and death, blessing and cursing. Therefore, choose life. Everybody say choose.
Choose
life, that both you and your descendants may live, that ye may love the Lord your God, that you may obey His voice, that ye may cling to Him, for He is your life
life and the length of your days, and that ye may dwell in the land which the Lord swore to your fathers, to Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, to give them. Can somebody say amen?
Amen.
Thank you for being reverent. You may be seated today. Choose life. I want to talk to you today about choices. The choices that we make in our life. This morning, according to research, we've already made about 250 choices since we've been awake. If you were awake about 8 o'clock this morning. Now, for some of you that didn't drag out of bed till 9:45 or 10:15 or whatever it was, that's between you and God. I'm not judging you. So you may not have made as many decisions as other people have made. I've been up since 4:30 this morning. I'm so excited, praise God, I'm moving back to Corbin working tomorrow morning. And don't have to leave my house till 6:45 instead of leaving at 4:30 in the morning. So praise God for answered prayer. So I'm a little excited. I'm a little excited about what God has done in my life. But we choose. And think about the choices that we make every day of our life. We are the world that we live in. We choose. We're going to McDonald's, or are we going to go to Wendy's? Are you a Ford man or a Chevy man? Somebody ought to be hooping and hollering, saying amen. We got some Dodge people in the house today. Came rolling up in Dodges today, right? We think about what we choose, how we're going to do it. Do we like Coke or do we like Pepsi? Amen. Brother Paul, he worked for Pepsi, and he told me one time that, you know, it was an unwritten policy. If you were out in public and drank Coke, you would lose your job. They were forced to drink Pepsi if you worked at the Pepsi plant. Amen. But some of you like Pepsi. Some of you like Coke, right? If I go to a restaurant and they got Coke, I'm getting Coke. If they got Pepsi, I'm getting Mountain Dew. I know it's one extreme or the other, but I don't like Pepsi. And I don't like Mellow Yellow or whatever you call it, Mellow Fellow Yellow or whatever it's called. I don't like that either, right? I like Mountain Dew and I like Coke. All my Coke drinkers say amen.
Amen.
You're the same way as me, right? We make all these choices every day. And society has put everything in the box. You've got to like this. You've got to be loyal. Some of you are more loyal to Chevrolet than you are Jesus Christ.
Come on.
My. It goes all the way back to the beginning from Adam and Eve, when Adam and Eve made a choice.
Right.
They had everything at their disposal, everything that they needed, everything that had to be. But they made a choice in what they decided. And guess what? We're paying for that choice thousands of years later. We make a choice about church. We make a choice about worship. We make a choice about how involved we're going to be, how faithful we're going to be. And then we make decision after decision after decision after decision. And I looked up decision. Think about this. Decision is a conclusion or resolution reached after consideration. A conclusion. What is a conclusion? It means to end something. I don't know why that makes some of you shout today when you think about what that means. But when you make a decision, it's supposed to end something. You can't be wishy-washy about it. It either is or it isn't. It's either black or it's white, it's red or it's blue. It is what it is. But how come when it comes to the things of God, we want to make a choice and we make a decision, but then we question everything else before we even get to the car? Amen. I'm telling you today that there is a choices that we have to make that are above and beyond our salvation. I know that I'm going to heaven, but my responsibility in life is not for me and my Ford and no more. It is to change the world and the community and the city and the state and everybody around me. I make a choice.
Hallelujah.
We make a choice who we marry, who your husband is going to be, who your wife is going to be. A young person, you make a choice of what kind of person you're going to be when you're in school. You make a choice when you walk down the hallways, kids at school, of who you're going to talk to, who you're not going to talk to.
Man.
You hear about this one, you hear about that one. I don't know about you, but if I could go back, I'd do one more thing. I would make sure that every class that I ever had, listen to me, every class that I ever had, I'd make sure I knew everybody in that class's name and I knew something special about them. Because there's times 25 years later that I run into them and I can't even remember their name. Or I remember their name, but I can never remember a conversation that I ever had with them. Why didn't I get to know? We miss out because of what? Because of the choices that we make in life. It's the same in church. We can love each other. We can get along. You can look around. You can get involved. You can be involved in prayer meeting. You can be involved in Bible study. Or you can just come in late and leave early. You can just show up when you want to. Whatever you want to do. It is a choice that you have to make. I can't make that for you. If I make the choice for you, you'd be here every time the door is open. Every time that I'm here, I want only with God, but my relationship with you means something to me.
Amen.
Amen. But I got to talk to you today about the family and the position of the family and what God has charged us to do in this life. In 1 Peter chapter 3, verse number 1, the Bible speaks to wives. How many wives do we have in here today? How many future wives do we have in here today? So you either fall into one or two categories, right? You either been there or you're going to be there, or you've been there and you don't ever want to be there again. Amen? Amen?
Amen.
Wives or potential wives. Likewise, be submissive to your own husband. To who? Wait a minute. Whose husband? Your own husband. Not your best friend's husband. Not your neighbor's husband. Your husband. Woo! That's a whole message right there, Roy. Amen?
Amen.
Said, wives, be submissive to your husbands. That even, listen to this, that even if some do not obey the word, they without the word may be won by the conduct of their wives. When they observe your chaste conduct accompanied by fear. Do not let your adornment be merely outward, arraying the hair, wearing gold, or putting on fine apparel. Listen, it wasn't saying you couldn't look good and have a little bling bling. That's not what it's saying right there, man. I told you, my dad even said, no barn needs a little paint every once in a while, amen? Amen?
Amen.
I'm coming back over here, amen? I feel safe zone over here. It's a little fiery right over there. So I'm not preaching against makeup. I'm not preaching against looking good. But he said, this is what he's trying to teach us here. He said, do not let your adornment be merely. What's it mean to be merely? Don't let it only be on the outside, but you should look as good on the inside as you do on the outside.
Amen.
And how many of you know you can't judge a book by its cover? And there's a lot of people on the outside that are more important than judging other people by their outward appearance. And they're going to split hell wide open because they don't have the love of God in their life.
Amen.
He's saying, don't do that. Rather, let it be hidden. Person of the heart, verse number 4, with the incorruptible beauty of the gentle and quiet spirit, which is very precious in the sight of God. Verse number 5, for in this manner, in former times, the holy women who trusted in God also adored themselves, being submissive to their husbands, as Sarah obeyed Abraham, calling him Lord, whose daughters you are. If you do good and are not afraid with any terror. Sarah, husband, called her husband Lord. I tried to get Leanna to call me Lord, Brandon, but it just didn't work out. Amen. I said, call me Lord. She called me a few other things. Amen. Verse number 7. You notice he spends 6 verses on the women folk, but he only spends 1 verse on the man folk. Amen. And the reason is because you've got to keep it simple for us. Right? Y'all need a little detail talking about the bling bling, the make it not. That's fine. Man, I need it short and I need it simple and to the point. Amen?
Amen.
You women all be saying amen. Husbands, likewise, dwell with them, listen to this, with understanding, giving honor. As to the weaker vessel, and as being heirs together of the grace of life, that your prayers may not be hindered. There's sometimes, men, that your prayers aren't being answered because you're not honoring your wife. You're not understanding your wife the way that God intends you to do. The most important attribute and thing that we have in our life is when the two shall become one. They Amen. Shall leave their father and mother and no longer be separate, but shall Amen. Be one Amen. Before God.
Amen.
But yet, the way some men speak to their wives,
Come on.
is a disgrace in the sight of God.
Amen.
Let's go on just a little bit here to Ephesians chapter 6. Children! Hey! Children! Where's my children? You got me? You got me? You with me? Do I need to come get you? You with me? Wave at me, children. Alright? Children! Obey your parents.
Amen.
In the Lord. You know what in the Lord is? That means obey your pastor too.
Amen.
Obey your youth leaders.
Amen.
Obey those that your teachers, those that God has put position and authority in your life. You are to listen to them with respect.
Yes.
Amen.
Honor your father and mother, which is the first commandment with promise, that ye may dwell with you and that ye may live long upon the earth. You want to know why some people don't live long? Because they do not honor their father and their mother. Not always. But that's the reason some don't. Honor your father and mother. Young people, show respect. There are some of you, not in this room necessarily, but in the society and in the middle schools and the high schools. And man, I've been a bus driver. I've been a substitute teacher. I've been a principal of a Christian school. I've been around a long time. Let me tell you, there's some of you that what you need, let me tell you what you need.
Come on.
Amen. Right here. You need discipline.
Amen.
Yes.
I don't always blame the kid.
Amen.
Right.
It's the parent's responsibility to teach our children.
Amen.
Respect.
That's right.
Right.
And I'm going to give you some statements and I'm going to say some things, and this is where it's about to get hairy. Kenny, I might need a bodyguard getting out of here today. You help me out, brother.
Bless my Lord.
Number one, no one likes an undisciplined child. You in Walmart, and you see a little kid going crazy, spinning around, head flipping all the way around, smacking on mama, spitting, doing whatever. Does he make you want to say, oh, you precious child, come and let me give you love. You're like, what do you say? If I could get a hold of that little kid. Ah! No one likes an undisciplined child. Some of you don't even like your own children. Number two, a child should not dictate when and where you go to church. Or where you sit.
Man.
Or what you eat. Or what happens when it comes to godly things. There were never a time in my life that I ever had to look at my father and say, Dad, are we going to church today? Mom, are we going to church today? It was not optional. It was like, breathe. Okay, we're breathing today, we're eating, and we're going to church. God forbid that you don't be faithful enough that your kids have to ask you the question, Mom and Dad, are we going to church today?
Amen.
We showing up? Husband, look at your wife. We going to church today? I don't know. You want to go? I don't care. You want to go? I don't know.
Good word.
Number three, God made the parent to lead, not to please and be their best friend. You want to know when you're your kid's best friend when they're 25, when they're 30, and they get out and they realize what you really mean to them.
Amen.
My dad's my hero. He wasn't when I was 16 years old. He wasn't supposed to be. And I can remember times when he had to discipline me. And he'd say to me, son, you have no idea how much this hurts me. I'm like, Dad, you have no idea how much this hurts me!
sometimes disciplined with tears. I didn't understand that. If you don't feel that, if you feel that bad, don't do it, man. Don't do it. But I thank God for every whipping I ever had in my life.
Amen.
I thank God that I lived a sheltered life. I thank God that I had parents that raised me in the fear and the admonition of God.
Yes.
Thank God I lived in a home. I didn't hear my dad yelling at my mom because I never heard my mom and dad argue. I never heard either one of them ever say a cuss word. We didn't watch things that were inappropriate. We didn't go places that were inappropriate. God was number one in our life, and I turned out okay.
Amen.
Maybe I didn't appreciate it at the time. Again, I don't blame the children for the way that they are. We have to take responsibility as parents.
Amen.
Amen.
Oh, Brandon, if you could preach this message to your kids in orientation to their parents. But you know what? Brandon will be the first to tell you, as a middle school teacher, you can't even get a hold of half their parents.
Yeah. Amen.
They get in trouble. They need help at school. You don't even know who to contact. Can't get a hold of them. They won't answer the phone. They don't answer the text. They won't answer the door. Because we've raised a generation of people that no longer care. They made a choice to not be the parents that God wants them to be in their life. And then they wonder why things have turned out the way that they are. I heard somebody say a long time ago, a river without a boundary is a flood.
That's right. Amen.
Kids need boundaries. Harvard did a study. 82% of teenagers said they did not mind discipline, but 90% agreed that the biggest issue that they had was with discipline was inconsistency of the parents.
Yeah.
You let them go, hey, kids are bringing you. I don't know. A river without a boundary is a flood. We've got to have boundaries. We've got to have rules. But you know what? If it's wrong on Monday, it needs to be wrong on Tuesday, not just because you're in a bad mood and fighting with your spouse, and suddenly you're going to go off and kill everybody. You got to be consistent with your discipline. If it's wrong today, it's wrong tomorrow. If the curfew's this time today, it's this time tomorrow. What is wrong with our generation? We made choices. You're failing the most important thing that God has given you, your family. And the church pews in most churches are empty right now, not because God's failing, but because parents are not training up their child in the way that they should go. You know, there are things that you can't choose. Number one, you can't choose who your parents are. See, you don't know what I went through. You don't know this one and know that one. It doesn't matter. You were fearfully and wonderfully made. In Jeremiah chapter 1 and 4, he said, before I formed thee in thy belly, I knew thee, and I ordained thee to be a prophet in the last days. He said, I know the thoughts I have for you, thoughts of good things, not evil things, in Jeremiah 29 and 11. God knows us, and He has placed us. He allowed us to get here by different avenues. And not everybody came from a nuclear home. Not everybody had a mom and dad. You can't choose who they are. But there's got to come a point in your life as an adult that you quit blaming your parents for the things that you've went through in your life. And you step up and you say, he was a lousy man, but that doesn't mean I have to be.
Man.
Or she was a lousy woman, but that doesn't mean I have to be. I can be better than they were. We don't have to make the same decisions that they make. We can learn from our parents in one or two ways. Either as good godly examples or examples of what not to be.
Amen.
Number one, we can't choose our parents. Or number two, you can't choose who your kids are. I know somebody I could give them back if you had an opportunity. To theirs. They belong to you. And you belong to them. And you have a responsibility. You have an obligation. You have an obligation. You say, how important is it to God? It is so important to God that He could have gave a tree. He could have sent a golden calf. He could have had a big, beautiful white stallion horse that was going to be a sacrifice. But He sent His own Son. Because He wanted to show the world how important that children should be in the sight of God. How many times did Jesus, when He was walking and talking upon the earth, talk about children? If you don't come as these children, then you've missed the whole thing. When He would say, if you would only have faith as these kids, you would have a better life. Kids aren't a problem, they're a blessing. And I counsel people all the time that are struggling with their kids. You've got to understand, your kids are going to grow up. Your kids are going to move out. And you're going to be with your spouse. And the things that you struggle with now, it's going to be a whole new realm. God only gives.
gives them to you for a season.
That's right.
But your marriage and your relationship is until death do you part.
Amen.
Amen.
Number three, you can't help who your family is. You can't choose who your family is. Man, we got some wackos, don't we, man? I'd like to trade some, but it don't work that way, Brother Bill. It just don't work that way. Amen. Unless you commit suicide, which is the most selfish way to end in life, to be honest. You don't get to choose when you die. And you can put it off and put it off and put it off and put it off and say, well, not today, maybe, maybe. And you know what? That kid's 5, that kid's 10, and before you know it, they're teenagers. Before, they're looking at you and saying, where were you? Can't go back. I can't change anything about yesterday. The only choice that I can make is right now. Right now. What is in front of me, what's behind me, always behind me. I can only be the man that God wants me to be. I can only get on my face and beg my wife to forgive me. I can only get my kids. Some of you need to get your kids together and say, you know what? I'm sorry. I wasn't the mother that I needed to be. I wasn't the father that I needed to be. But I want to do everything in my power to make it up to you today. The kids will understand when an adult won't. You made a choice to be here today.
Amen.
And I'm glad that you did. Because God sent you here to me today to challenge you. To challenge you. As I preached a few months back, to challenge your circumstance in your life. Sure, something yesterday. If you're not married, you didn't get a text from me, but I sent a survey to the husbands and the wives of our church that are married. And I just simply, as the Holy Spirit led me, asked some questions. We use this little app called Survey Monkey. It's an app. It compiles all the information together. It sends it back to me. I don't know the name of the people that take the survey. It just calls them respondent 1, respondent 2, respondent 3, and so on. It doesn't tell me, you know, Bill filled it out, or doesn't go by your name. It has nothing. I have, as God's moments, I have no earthly idea how any of you women filled your survey out. Or you men. But I want to share some statistics today. Is that all right?
Amen.
I want you to notice the difference in the husband's responses than the women's. I ask our men 9 questions. I ask the ladies 10. Number 1, I consider my wife to be my best friend. 100% of every husband said yes.
Amen.
Again, I'm not talking about Family Feud, 100 people survey, top 5 answer the door. I'm talking about people sitting in this room today.
Amen.
Keep that in mind. I ask you, men, I consider my wife a godly Christian woman. 100% of our husbands said yes. Number 3, I ask, I'm proud when my wife takes care of the family. 100%. By the way, in the women's responses, there were no 100% answers. My wife fully supports me in the call of God that He has on my life. 100%. Every man said, I know my wife has my back. I wish my wife would be more interested in things that really matter to me.
56% of the men said yes, I wish they were. My wife reads her Bible and prays daily.
No, mommy.
67, two out of every three said no. Doesn't happen. I consider my marriage to be healthy and in good shape. Two out of three women say yes, but one out of three said no. There are things that I struggle with that my wife knows nothing about. 78% of you men said yes. You big dummy! You call her your best friend?
Man.
And 78% of you got things in your life that you're struggling with that you haven't even told your wife. Shame on you!
Come on.
Come on.
You're a fake! You're a hypocrite! Amen.
Come on.
Don't call her your best friend and hide things from her.
Come on.
Amen.
78%! It's hypocrisy. My wife is fulfilling the call of God on her life. 58% said yes. 44% said, women, they don't think you're doing what you need to do when it comes to God. More than two out of three. Or more than one out of three. Guys, I'm going to be honest with you. The ladies' survey was real. It was more honest. You better wake up. I ask the ladies, my husband prays with me every day. 89% of our ladies said no, he doesn't. When it comes to spiritual things in the home, my husband is the leader. Two out of three said no, you're not. I wish my husband would step up and become the spiritual leader he needs to be. Two out of three said yes, he needs to step up. He shows the kids the love and affection they deserve. 56% said you don't. My husband is consistent in his walk with God. 56%. There are things in my husband's life that he struggles with that he denies are there. Two out of three said yes. So you 78% saying you struggle with things that your wife doesn't know about. She's smarter than you think she is. And she's probably more your best friend than you are hers. And she recognizes there are things in your life that you're struggling with. Choices. I feel my husband is fulfilling the call of God in his life. I feel like my husband's being a man of God the way that he needs to be. 78%. Our marriage is beyond doubt very healthy. You hear me? Two out of every three of our women in our church said, no, it's not. Our church.
Come on.
Your wife. My husband has no idea what I'm struggling with because he's so preoccupied. Over half, 56%, say you don't have a clue. You don't realize. You don't even realize what I'm doing. Choices. Joshua found himself. Gideonites, many nights coming against him.
And everybody's saying, let's do it this way, let's do it that way, let's do it our own way, let's do what needs to be. We don't need to just serve God. We need to have idols. We need to have all these other things. We need our kids to be on the soccer team. We need our kids to play basketball. We need our kids to do this. They need to be popular. It's more important for them to be popular than godly.
Come on.
I struggle with it too.
Come on.
I took the survey too. And so did my wife. And Joshua one day said, enough's enough. And he drew a line in the sand. And he said, who's for him and who's against him? As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord.
Man.
As for me and my house, we're going to serve God.
Yes.
So here's what has to happen today. When we find ourselves about the choices, when we find ourselves about the things that we're going through in life, is that there's got to be some folks that will draw a line in the sand and say, you know what? It may not have been perfect. It may not be what everybody thought it was going to be. It may have evolved to what it is right now. But I've got to make sure that I'm being the man of God. Listen to me. If
man.
My wife doesn't believe in me, I don't want to be up here.
Come on.
She's my biggest fan. She's my biggest encourager. She's my biggest a supporter. And she can't put her faith in a hypocrite.
That's right. Come on.
And I don't do what I do just because I love God. I do what I do because I love her. And I respect her.
Amen.
And I value her. And I value her opinion of me. Because it matters.
Amen.
Please. If you've ever listened to me, listen to me now. Do not ask your wife what she said on the survey.
Amen.
Wives, do not discuss with your husband. That is between them and God. Because it's nice to see some people be real and be honest.
Man.
How many to be honest that they passed around? That was a little mind-blowing to see some of those things. Why don't you raise your hand and say, wow. Where do you fall? Where do you fall today? Husbands, wives, children, grandparents. By the way, grandparents, counseled people for 20 years. I would say half of the issues that parents have with their kids in discipline is because the grandparents are overbearing. I'm not saying you are. Lord, help me.
Bless the Lord.
But how many of you know that could be that way?
Amen.
They interfere in our discipline. They interfere with what we feel like their morals and values should be. Man, it got quiet in here fast. Didn't I warn you though? Didn't I tell you ahead of time? Where are we today? Where do we stand? What are the choices? What are we going to choose? Do we choose life or do we choose death? Where do we go from here? What happens in a church? We're in a church now. We're coming up on a year. We've been here. We've had great stories of restoration. You've got people here today that are listening to this that need to make choices in your life. You've got to make a decision on what you need to do and how your life needs to be. But you have to make a decision. Once you become restored, you don't go back and have to get restored again and go back and have to get restored again and go back. There should come a point when you stand on your own two feet and you help someone
Amen.
Else experience restoration.
Yes. Well,
right? And when you get victory over things in your life, what's it going to take? I've never counseled a couple. I've told you this before. Where the wife sat there and said, you know what, Pastor? He just spends way too much time with me. He's just spending way too much time with the kids. All he wants to do is kiss on me and hug me and love on the kids. All he wants to do is spend time, blah, 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 blah. No. He's never there. He's zoned out. He's checked out. There's other things that are more important to him than me. And there's a wall that is built. And that wall is invisible. And that wall is easier for a woman to see than a man.
Come on.
That's why you big dummies, the first four questions were all, yeah, 100%. My wife's my best friend. My wife's a godly woman. My wife's a good mama. You big dummy. You don't even see what's happening in your life. Because that's the way we are. I finally figured something out yesterday. Leanna wanted me to do something. But I didn't really know if she wanted me to do it or she was just saying she wanted me to do it. Right? So I agreed to do it. But then when I agreed to do it, I agreed to do it with a certain look on my face. Which made it look like I was agreeing to do it, but I really didn't want to do it. Does that make sense to any man in here today?
Amen.
So sometimes you just got to... Yes. So then, she gave me an opportunity to get out of what I was doing that I may or may not have really wanted to do. So I didn't know if I should exit out of the option that she was giving me or politely say, no, it's all right. I'm going to go ahead and do it. And I went to bed with a headache last night trying to figure it out. Because that's the way women work. Right?
Amen.
We don't have a clue sometimes.
How would it feel and how would it be if you realized that the most precious thing that you had in your life you were getting ready to lose
and you didn't even realize it?
Amen.
Right. Or how would it be to a man to gain the whole world and lose his soul? Wait a minute, that's in the Bible, isn't it? So here's what today. I told you this message today is on family. Thank you for participating. I'm begging you, don't ask. Don't ask. Don't go there. Please. Respect your spouse enough to let them be honest with your parents.
Amen.
Please.
Amen.
I think it's time for a little self-evaluation today. Moms, dads, boys, girls, that's all of us. We're all here, right?
Amen.
We're a parent, we're a grandparent, we're married, we're divorced, we're on the brink. Wherever you are today, whatever you, actually, Greg, go ahead and have something ready for us to play. Number four. Wherever you are today, does your spouse know it? Do you know? I think it's time. Somebody said, Pastor, how honest do you need to be in a relationship? You need to be so honest that honesty is never even an issue.
Amen.
Amen.
It's never brought up. I want you to stand with me, if you will, real very reverently and quietly this morning. I want you to please bow your head just for a moment. Close your eyes and reverence. There's no looking around. How many of you would say to me, Pastor, you've got my attention this morning? Would you raise your hand? Thank you for being here. God bless you. God bless you. I'm challenging you today to make a choice. To make a choice to change the circumstance that you're facing in your life. Change it. Change it. You can change. You can do better. But you got to be real with yourself. You got to be real with the circumstance. Lord, right now, I just pray that you would give our men and women and boys and girls the courage today to make a choice. There's some of you, you need to take that little sweet thing that God gave you by the hand, and you should bring them to the altar with you this morning and lead them in prayer. There are some of you that are here alone that you need to come and you need to turn over some things to God, and you need to make a choice this morning. There are some of you that just need to come by yourself and you need to spend some time with God. Whoever you are and wherever you are, come as you are this morning. Come as you are. I challenge you right now, make a choice, step out of your seat. Go ahead, reach him by the hand right now. Step out of your seat right now and come to this altar and spend some time in prayer. Will you come? I'll be here if you need me. Leanne will be with me. If you need prayer, we'll be right over here. Lay down your hands. Lay down.